Thank you, sir. And I would like to thank Santan for the opportunity. Let me just share my slide. So basically, what we are looking at in dry eye patients is something beyond just a symptomatic relief that they have by putting some lubricating drop in their eye. And I would like to thank Santan for providing the slide deck for this talk. So when you look at treatment options as far as dry eye is concerned, you have a you can start off with strategies, you can have various tier supplements, and of various tier supplements, you have n number of brands with n number of molecules. You can look at options of how you would want to do a procedure to retain the tears on the ocular surface. You could look at specialized contact lenses. You could look at biological tear substitutes or tear simulators. And you have a significant number of patients where you would be probably looking at some kind of an anti-inflammatory therapy with probably a low dose of corticosteroid at some point of time versus cyclosporine A or lifitegrast as such. But when you look at all these treatment options, you need to know where you would want to position which treatment. And that to a certain extent, Deuce One has given us a reasonable guideline as to how you would go ahead with prescribing medication. So if it's a step one dry eye or a very mild dry eye, you're basically looking at environmental modifications and you could use any lubricants. And if it is an occasional use of lubricant, even those with a little bit of preservatives is not going to be that harmful to the ocular surface. The step two, where your frequency of lubricating drops is more, is where you would definitely want to shift over to either a disappearing preservative or a completely preservative-free formulation, or a formulation which has preservatives which is less toxic to the ocular surface when used on a repeated basis. Step two would be the time that you would even look at anti-inflammatory treatment modalities, whether it is lifitegrast, whether it is cyclosporine. In an Indian context, you also have the option of using topical topical chloroquine, even though the published literature is not significantly available, but that's something that we do have. Again, you would look at antibiotics, which could take care of the blepharitis. You could look at tetracycline for its anti-inflammatory effect also, especially when it is associated with the rosacea-induced blepharitis and dry eye disease. And you would look at temporary plugs. And this group, you can even look at if the MGD is significant, you would probably look at giving the option of a lippy flow or an IPL as far as these patients are concerned. A step three, where the severity is more severe, you will probably look at shifting to an autologous serum or a therapeutic bandage contact lens, or more commonly a permanent punctal occlusion, probably with a cautery, which would try to retain the existing tears on the ocular surface and would try to retain the tear drop that the patient puts on the eye for a longer period of time. And in a very severe, you're looking at surgical transplant more for complications of the dry eye disease or in terms of a tarsorrhaphy to try to reduce the surface area that is exposed and try to make the patient a little bit more comfortable. So this gives us a broad outline as to where we would fit each molecule that we have in our armamentarium as far as treating dry eye is concerned. Coming to the Dry Eye Society, which gave its classification of dry eye, and it also gave something called as a tear film oriented therapy. Now, this is something which is new from an Indian context point of view, because here they gave a description of tear film based dynamics, which is different in an aqueous tear deficiency as compared to a mucin deficiency, as compared to evaporative dry eye. And then they gave suggested options in what would be the molecule of choice when you're talking about lubricants in each disease. So if you're looking at a lipid layer deficiency, you're probably looking at using dicarbazole. If you're looking at an aqueous deficiency, you're probably looking at something like a sodium hyaluronate or a dicarbazole or a rebapamide when it's associated with mucin deficiency also. And if you have primarily epithelium or mucin associated issues, you have the option of using dicarbazole or rebapamide. And if you have ocular surface inflammation, you're looking at cyclosporine, steroids, or rebapamide. By and large, what goes across all this, the entire spectrum, dicarbazole seems to be involved whether there's a lipid layer deficiency, whether there's an aqueous deficiency, whether there's an epithelial issue, whether there's inflammation. Unfortunately, from an Indian point of view, dicarbazole is not available in an Indian market, and we are waiting for Santan to launch it in the Indian market as such. But what is available out of these molecules here is probably sodium hyaluronate. And when you're looking at sodium hyaluronate, let's look at the properties. Nikhil has already mentioned it, just it's going to be a rehearsal of the same thing. To a certain extent, it can bind to about 6,000 times its weight of water molecule, and it does get retained on the ocular surface for a longer period of time, increase the corneal wettability, and it has highly good viscoelastic properties. So these are properties that you would ideally want in a lubricating agent. But in addition to that, it does have effects on the epithelium, as Nicholas already mentioned. So when you have an epithelial healing issue, or when you have the epithelium which is not healthy, the sodium hyaluronate actually binds to the fibronectin and it facilitates an epithelial extension. And in this manner, it accelerates the wound healing. So in rabbit models or in animal models, they've actually shown that when you just give sodium hyaluronate versus any of the competitor lubricating drops, an epithelial defect which has been artificially created either by a blade or by using chemical tends to heal faster when you use sodium hyaluronate as compared to just a competitive lubricating drop. So what is the evidence that is available clinically that we have? So this basically study as a breakup index ratio. Now, what is a breakup index ratio? It's basically a ratio of the breakup time after installation of the drop versus a breakup time before installation of the drop. So this difference is calculated and it is done for patients who were given sodium hyaluronate and patients who were given a random artificial tear. And if you look at the graph for the first half an hour, both the arcs are almost the same. But after that, after the first 20 minutes, to be precise, the sodium hyaluronate group significantly has retained a better breakup ratio throughout almost for a 2 hour period. So that tells us that it increases the breakup time and it is able to maintain it at least for a two-hour period, and this maintenance is much better than what a competitor lubricating drop would give. And if you look at an absolute breakup value in terms of the non-invasive breakup time that you would get in these eyes, when you compare the vehicle alone of sodium hyaluronate versus the molecule itself, there is a significant improvement in the breakup time with the molecule. And this is much more than just the vehicle alone. So you cannot attribute the improvement in the breakup time just to the vehicle. There is a significant component of the actual molecule, which is increasing the breakup time, and it is able to maintain it or sustain it almost till a 3 hour period. Even till a 3 hour period, it is higher. So effectively, this basically tells us that if you put a molecule of sodium hyaluronate on the eye, you would improve the tear breakup for a period of 3 hours. So to a certain extent, you can say that you can reduce the installation of drops in the eye, at least give a gap of around 3 to 4 hours, because you know that the molecule is probably going to stay in the eye for that much period of time. Again, this will depend on the severity of the dry eye that the patient has. Somebody who has an absolutely no Schirmer's will still need a higher volume of a higher frequency of lubricating drops. Somebody who has, say, a 4 or a 5 or a borderline Schirmer's will be much more comfortable just with a 4-time or a 5-time installation of sodium hyaluronate as a molecule. The next thing is, what is the subjective comfort that the patient has? And if you're looking at the subjective comfort, and this study looked at the symptom comfort in terms of dryness, grittiness, and stinging. And when they compared it at day zero, if you look at day zero, the both the study and the both the groups tended to have the same amount of complaints. And as time goes by, day 35, day 84, the dryness component, the grittiness, and the stinging seem to be significantly better in the group which received sodium hyaluronate as compared to the group that received CMC. Again, between the three symptoms, the grittiness and the stinging seem to be significantly better with sodium hyaluronate as compared to the CMC molecule as such. And more patients expressed their satisfaction with a 0.1% HA than with a 0.5% CMC on day 35 of treatment. So this basically tells us that even when you're looking at a patient comfort point of view, sodium hyaluronate seems to be performing better than a competitor 0.5% CMC drop alone. And if you're looking at objective parameters, so you can look at breakup, which we've already said, it increases the breakup significantly for a 3 hour period. And if you're looking at the next objective parameter would be the staining of the ocular surface. So you started off with a similar amount of staining in both the groups. In the group with 0.5% CMC, there is about a 56% decrease in the staining. And in the group with a 0.1% HA, there is about a 64% decrease in staining. Both the medicines would cause a decrease in staining because there is dry eye which is causing the epithelial issues, and you are addressing the dry eye, whether it is with CMC or whether it is with HA. But the improvement in the surface epithelial irregularity is much higher when you have used sodium hyaluronate as compared to a CMC alone. And at day 84, the reduction was significantly more in the group which got sodium hyaluronate as compared to the CMC group alone. So to conclude my talk, basically when you're looking at a molecule, you would want to ideally, or a tier supplement, you would want it ideally to replace all the three layers of the tiers. You would want it to replace the lipid layer, you would want it to replace the mucin, and you would want it to replace the aqueous. Unfortunately, in India, we do not have a molecule which does all three, like that which is available in Japan. Sodium hyaluronate as a molecule does affect two of these, because it does bind to the mucin and delivers further hydration to the ocular surface over an expanded period of time. It can hold on to the water molecules for a longer period of time on the ocular surface. So it improves the tear meniscus height to a certain extent. It improves the stability of the tears on the ocular surface by increasing the breakup time. It improves the ocular surface status by reducing the corneal and conjunctival staining on the ocular surface as compared to just a routine CMC drops. It improves not just the subjective symptoms, but it also objectively improves the ocular surface signs that we see in a dry eye disease. And it does have laboratory results to show that it does help in corneal epithelial epithelialization also. And like Nikhil mentioned, it does have issues with, it does have a role probably in some kind of a neurodegeneration and in anti-inflammatory effects. So by and large, this is a molecule which has multiple effects. Yes, we would want it to have some amount of lipid also in it to give it a complete tier supplement package. But till we reach that, at this point of time, this seems to be a useful molecule in most patients with dry eye. I would like to conclude by thanking you.